For many people, social media is the place to be for education, entertainment, or just to pass the time. And for businesses, social media is only becoming more and more important to promoting that company and selling their products or services. Right about now, I'd normally be introducing our guest and expert to you all, but for this episode, we're lucky enough to already know him. Today, we have Nick Hill, our in-house digital media guru and my co-host, to tell us all about how social media can be used for good. Welcome to The Good Guide to Business, a podcast presented by the Better Business Bureau.
It's all about conversations with businesses, organizations, and local leaders who are going above and beyond to make our community a better place.
So grab a cup of coffee, sit down, and get ready to hear this episode's topic, how to use social media to promote and find sustainable and socially responsible businesses. So let's start on the business side of things first. First of all, there's so many social media platforms out there. Some I'm sure I don't even know about.
Yeah.
How do businesses decide where to focus their attention right now?
Then you are missing a huge free marketing opportunity. You think like Gen Z, millennials. You know, everybody's on social media. Even older generations are, and it's become a huge place for brands to communicate. Not just what they offer, but to provide customer service experiences and really connect with individuals. So social media in general, you know, we may think of it as like a fun thing to do to pass the time. It's a legitimate marketing opportunity. So if you're not already on social media, it's something you should absolutely consider. But if you are on social media and you're not really sure where to go from there, I really have some tips that I hope can help. You know, it really just depends on what you do and what platforms are right for you. You really don't want to stretch yourself too thin and be on all of these platforms because that can kind of dilute your message, dilute what you do. And if you're able to focus your effort on, let's say, two or three social networks, then it becomes a lot bigger, a lot more efficient of an effort. So I want to start by breaking down each social network and the different ways that they're used to best kind of promote a message. I'm sure everybody at this point, their parents, their grandparents are on Facebook, right? We know Facebook is kind of a great general platform for pretty much anything. Facebook kind of takes elements from other smaller social networks and builds them into their own network. So that's why it's kind of a good general platform. So Facebook will have Facebook stories. There's great opportunities for video on Facebook. And of course, the traditional text posts as well. It's important to consider too that the Facebook generation is typically an older demographic. So if you are going to be marketing on there, you may be seeing results skewed toward, again, an older demographic. Instagram is probably my most favorite to use just because of how visual it is. I like taking pictures, making content, and Instagram's awesome for that. They started out primarily focused on the visual medium through images. And if you really want to show off your products, your initiatives in a visual manner, Instagram's perfect for that. You maybe don't want to type and post a 5-paragraph long caption with your Instagram photos. But if you are looking to really showcase the things that make your business shine, Instagram's awesome for that.
Well, and there's some stuff that you can sort of recycle Instagram and Facebook together, right? Because, I mean, Facebook, well, Meta owns Instagram. Isn't there like a tie-in with that to make it a little bit easier?
Yeah, you can cross-post and have your Facebook posts appear on Instagram and vice versa, I believe. And their marketing center, Meta Ads, is actually working for both. So Better Business Bureau, we have our ads run through Meta, and we run them the same ads on Facebook and Instagram. It's really easy since they're tied in like that. But kind of different demographics on them as well. I think Instagram kind of skews younger than Facebook, definitely. LinkedIn, you got to think of that as being pretty much all business. There's some fun stuff on LinkedIn, but
That's really like recruiting employees mostly, right? Or like other businesses.
Yeah, LinkedIn is really B2B and business to employees.
Like networking more than selling stuff.
Right. But, you know, you kind of think networking, especially if you're a brand, you're kind of selling yourself and you're selling your story. So LinkedIn is like really awesome for if you want to show off maybe some of the benefits that your company offers that maybe others don't. You know, LinkedIn, I think, is a perfect platform for that.
Right.
TikTok is wild.
Right.
We have not even dabbled in that. I'm kind of afraid to because of how different it is from everything else.
Yeah. Well, and I think your point in the beginning about, like, not stretching yourself too thin with social platforms, that's a big reason why we haven't dabbled into TikTok. Other than that, it's like a whole beast that we don't really know how to tackle.
Right.
There are companies who someone's whole job is just being their TikTok manager. Like, not even all of social media, literally just TikTok.
Or whole teams. You got to think like these companies that are really
utilizing
TikTok.
I'm sure Scrub Daddy has multiple people that only do TikTok.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. And going off of that, I don't know how many of our listeners and viewers are familiar with Scrub Daddy's TikToks, but that's like a lot of what we see from brands is they don't really showcase their products or what they do. It's them kind of being funny. Because, you know, the demographic that's on TikTok is mostly younger people. Yeah. And they don't really want to be marketed to. They don't want it being so explicit. So if a brand can just utilize humor.
Yeah, it's if a brand can entertain me or not. And that makes people want to use their product.
Exactly.
Which is kind of wild because otherwise, like, we're so used to advertising being like, is the product good? Is it something that I want to use? Is it useful to me? And TikTok TikTok's marketing for a lot of companies has, like you said, literally nothing to do with whether or not the product is good, even though it usually is for those bigger brands. But, like, it's just so wild.
Well, think about this. How many other sponge brands can you name and think of?
Yeah, none.
Exactly. Because Scrub Daddy is, I mean, they've really kind of cornered the market on sponge marketing through TikTok. Yeah, I just think TikTok, it's if you can be good at TikTok, that's awesome. It maybe is not the easiest place to jump in, especially if you're trying to showcase your brand's mission and showcase those kinds of things.
And I think from what I've seen, it seems to work best for product-based businesses. Like, I don't see a lot of service-based businesses for like BBB, for example. I know there's some BBBs that have TikTok, but it seems like product-based businesses do a lot better on there because they can just be funny.
Right.
Instead of focusing on like trying to be serious and get a message across, which sometimes works, but
yeah,
funny definitely wins most of the time.
I'm sure there's a demographic for that on TikTok. Like, my mom's on TikTok and she maybe isn't as entertained by Duolingo's TikToks as I am. She maybe wants to see something more serious. So I'm sure there's a place for it. I don't think it's one of the first platforms you should try, though.
Right. Yeah. I think that's a good point, too, though, because there seems to be a misconception for a lot of people that TikTok is not even millennial, but like Gen Z only. And so it's like kids who aren't adults yet. Therefore, it's not an important place to market to people. But there are all kinds on TikTok, like so many more people than you think spend hours of their day scrolling through TikTok, adults included, of all ages. So, I mean, if you can figure out how to do it successfully, it's definitely something you should probably think seriously about doing.
Yeah, because if you can knock it out of a park, by all means, it could be a huge asset for your business. But I think also when considering platforms, it's really important to consider how you're able to differentiate content between platforms. You know, your customers aren't going to want to see the same thing on Twitter as they do on Facebook or Instagram. So it's really important to kind of differentiate what you're posting where, even if it's just changing up the caption, because different platforms, as we just discussed, have different affordances.
Okay, so when businesses are trying to figure out, they've figured out what platforms they're going to be on. How do they figure out what content to post, like how to get a following and promote their business?
Well, the good thing about social media is you don't always have to post your content. A lot of what you can do, especially to gain a following, is done through sharing content. You know, you really should try to find an individual, an influencer, or maybe another brand who really aligns with your company's mission, and then share relevant content from them. That not only differentiates what your followers see coming from you, you know, gives them more fresh content to interact with, but it also will boost your place in the algorithm in a lot of places. Across all social media, they really kind of ding companies that don't interact with other accounts. So by sharing content from other accounts, you are actually jumping on that algorithm wave and boosting how many people see your posts.
Yeah, that's something I feel like we should talk about a little bit more, because I don't do our social media, therefore I don't have to keep up with the algorithms. So I don't know how they work. And I'm sure a lot of people also don't know how algorithms work. And how do you keep up with them? Like, where do you find information on the changes and all of that?
You just have to really be on top of it, and every so often look into seeing how the algorithms changed. A lot of the times you can't even tell. Like, sometimes I think Instagram's pretty good with telling you how their algorithm changes, but maybe like Twitter or TikTok, they're not necessarily going to come out and say, this is how the algorithm works, because then everybody's just going to utilize that and it kind of dilutes what you see. So you really just have to kind of experiment in ways to see what works for you and what doesn't. And we do that here at BBB. So I schedule our social media posts through Hootsuite. And Hootsuite, it lets you see what times are best for posting. When is the absolute best time each day per platform I can send out a post?
And is it the same pretty much every day?
No.
Or it's different every day?
It fluctuates and it will change week by week. And I think that's a part of the algorithm too. So there's different tools you can use, Hootsuite being one of them. There's others too that can show you more in depth, like how well you're doing with the algorithm. And you can gauge from there. Hootsuite will also tell you, we're not sponsored by Hootsuite. I'm just saying this as an example because this is what we use. Hootsuite and other platforms will tell you when the best time to post is. But it'll also tell you, like, you know, you've gotten so much engagement this day. You've gotten so many more followers in this week. And that way you can kind of gauge, like, hey, this new thing I'm doing, is this helping with the algorithm or is this hurting?
Yeah, and not to, you know, hammer on Hootsuite more, but that's probably an important thing, too, to note that for people that are just trying to figure out how to do social media for their businesses, you're not going on each individual platform and posting just willy-nilly. Like, there's a system, and Hootsuite, like, you can have all your feeds on there, so you only have to go to one place to post all of them, right? Is that right?
You're exactly right. And if, especially when you get to the point when you have multiple social media accounts for your business, it gets really tiring going from platform to platform, posting individually there. So programs like Hootsuite, where everything gets aggregated, saves you a lot of time, saves you a lot of effort too, because posting on social media can be quite draining.
Right. Takes up a lot of time. I mean, it takes up a lot of time the way you do it, so I can't imagine if you don't use something like that.
Right. Exactly. Another huge point that I think is just absolutely, probably paramount, is that you should really try to be as authentic as you can on social media, especially if you're trying to market toward a younger generation. I think, you know, Gen Z, millennials, people who've grown up with social media, they can kind of see right through when a brand is not being authentic. And when that happens, of course, we're not going to want to work, align ourselves, shop with a brand that's not authentic.
Right, right. Can you elaborate on, like, authenticity? Like, what do you mean by that?
Right. You know, just so a big part of authenticity is, you know, you don't try to sugarcoat things. If there's any sort of issue in your company, you know, you address that.
Right. And with social media now, people are going to find out.
Exactly.
So, yeah.
Right. You don't try to bury things, because on social media too, you know, once it's out there, it's out there forever. Mm-hmm. So that part of authenticity is huge. But also, you got to show every part of your business to be authentic. You know, not everybody wants to see just the glamorous parts. Like, some of the best accounts I see, they will show their day-to-day activities of their employees. You know, show what the people that actually make this business run look like, what their days are. And I think that really helps, especially the younger generations. It helps us relate mm-hmm. when they're authentic like that.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Because you want to relate to, like, another human being. And in that way, I feel like, I don't know, the opposite of that, I think of, like, TV advertising, mm-hmm. which seems so, I know it's not obsolete to a lot of people, but it seems so just, like, something I don't consume anymore. We don't even have cable.
Yeah.
So, like, I don't know. That is so out of my brain now as far as marketing goes that I don't even understand why people still make them. I know they make a lot of money, especially Super Bowl commercials and stuff like that. They make a lot of money off those. But it is crazy how much marketing seems to be changing drastically from that to what we're talking about.
Right. And what we're talking about, even that's changing day by day. A year ago, maybe we wouldn't have been even talking about TikTok's power as a marketing platform.
Well, yeah, I mean, TikTok, like, things like TikTok Shop are, like, what, months old, barely?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's a whole other thing we should tackle sometime, talking about TikTok Shop more. Mm-hmm. Stay tuned, possibly.
I don't even understand it. I don't use it. Probably won't. Yeah.
But I think going back to being authentic, too, I mentioned sharing day-to-day activities in your company. Just pictures, I think, can go a long way. Whether that's, like, the normal activities in your business or you sharing, like, this awesome service project you've done, I find that, at least on our BBB Instagram, pictures of us doing something, whether that's the podcast or going out at a community event, they perform so much better than just, like, a graphic guide I'll make. Mm-hmm. So that's what people want to see, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Well, and I'm jumping ahead a little bit because we're going to talk about that later, but that's why I think video content has become such a, like, powerhouse in everything.
Yeah, definitely.
For influencers and for businesses, and, like, that's why Instagram Reels exists, and obviously TikTok does so well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it all boils down to that authenticity. People just want to see more of you being you.
Yeah.
And you really have to be intentional with it, too. I don't think you need to go post your coworker sitting at their desk sending an email. But if it's something that really relates to your mission, something that you think could be powerful, it doesn't hurt to share it.
Especially, I mean, since, like, that's what our podcast is all about, but focusing on businesses that are doing things to promote sustainability or improve their community and that sort of thing, like, you should be sharing all of that.
Oh, yeah.
Like, anytime you're doing any sort of community event or volunteer work or anything where people are gathered for something to do with your business, like, if you want to do well on social media, that should be online. A lot of it.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And when you do that too, you have to make sure if you're in the community talking with people, tag them, use hashtags. All that too, like, will boost your engagement so much, even from just the picture.
Yeah. Well, and, like, in that same mode, tagging other businesses, like, if you're doing anything with another business, which a lot of nonprofits work with other nonprofits as an example, like, they should all be interacting on social media just like they do in real life, because it only helps both of them, right?
Right. And I think, too, at least with Instagram, I've seen this, that boosts your place in the algorithm as well. The
right.
more relevant people you tag. Don't just tag whoever in your post.
Yeah, like the mass tagging stuff you see with, like, scam posts and all of that.
Yes, that will actually hurt you in the algorithm.
In similarly, like, what is your take on hashtags? Because I know, like, there's a lot of different versions, but some people put, like, as many as possible. Like, what do you think about it?
I think it's one of those things that depend on the platform. So, like, LinkedIn and Facebook and especially Twitter, where you're limited on your characters, since they don't really have the drop-down option like Instagram does, you have to limit yourself. Mm-hmm. Like, 2 to 3, I think, is golden for most platforms. But Instagram's really different, where since it does have the drop-down caption, you know, when you scroll on your feed, like, the caption's, like, you'll see a sentence or two, but the rest is hidden.
Right.
You have to press to show more of it. That gives you more space to show the other hashtags. Typically on Instagram, we max it out with 30. And we find that that's algorithm-wise, that works. It's a good thing to do. And of course, you know, having hashtags helps. It helps people find things that are related to the hashtag if used correctly. Again, these algorithms will ding you if you're just tagging something like I post a picture of us volunteering at a Shred event and tagged it ice cream. Their algorithm model will be able to see it. Hey, this is not a picture of ice cream. And then it'll hurt your place in the algorithm.
Right. So don't just post random stuff, including random hashtags about something that has nothing to do with. That makes sense.
Yes. All has to be intentional.
Yeah. And we already talked about being responsive for the sake of the algorithm. But what about, especially for businesses that are, again, trying to do good stuff in the community and all of that, you want people to have good opinions about you. So what can you do on social media with your account to help that? And in turn, like, maintain and gain followers.
Yeah. I think social media is just another opportunity you can use to leverage trust. If you are transparent and responsive on social media, that builds further trust with your consumers and your partners. And we all know trust is a huge pillar. So that goes all the way down to responding to comments. If somebody has a question and you respond to them, answer their question thoroughly, respectfully, that's going to go a long way to help put your brand in a positive spotlight. The same goes for any sort of messages. Any opportunity you can use to be transparent, promote trust is going to be huge. And we see that happen a lot on social media. There's a lot of those opportunities. And also, I've been talking about algorithms a lot. If you respond to comments and respond to direct messages, should also help your place in the algorithm.
Yeah, well, the comment thing seems kind of like it, similar to seeing how businesses deal with complaints, especially on our website, bbb.org. But we have a complaint system where consumers can write complaints about like interactions that they've had with businesses if they think something went wrong. And then we give the businesses the opportunity to respond, and all of that is posted on the complaint. And nowadays, a lot of people like to do their complaining on social media, which sometimes is not great, but sometimes it is. And then that gives the business the opportunity to publicly solve the issue.
Right.
And other people see that. So you're not just helping that customer. You're showing publicly that you can handle those situations and make it right. And that can help your image to people a lot, I think.
Yeah, that is a fantastic point. I think, you know, there's been times where I've seen companies respond to complaints on social media and then just absolutely knock it out of the park with the response. And that has gone a long way in my mind, helping their image.
Yeah, like sometimes it goes viral just because they like did a really good job of making things right with their customer, and people really like them way more than they did before, or discovered them through that or whatever.
So. You're exactly right. But there are sometimes too where things have just gone so south and there's very little opportunity where you think you could salvage that. At that point, it doesn't hurt to say, hey, you know, I'm sorry this happened. I'd love to help. Please DM us. Mm-hmm. That way you can kind of take it out of the public light and solve whatever issue is happening in your DMs.
Right.
So that way you still use social media as a customer service platform, but you don't necessarily have to make all these issues going on public.
Yeah, I can see how that could be tricky. I think the biggest thing is to not, even if it's private, because people will screenshot stuff and put it publicly on whatever platform you're on. So even if you're in someone's DMs, you always want to be like as nice as possible. Obviously, that's normal customer service advice. But like, even if it's on social media, like, don't say anything that you wouldn't want a ton of people to see, I guess is what I'm saying.
Right. And if you are saying something, make sure you're ready for a ton of people to see.
Mm-hmm.
If it can be positive, then that's awesome.
Yeah, because what we've learned, especially with TikTok over the last couple of years, is anybody, anything can end up blowing up on a platform like TikTok. I feel like it, and that's great in a lot of ways. Like, it lends itself to people having a lot more opportunity to get a lot of views and have a lot of followers than I think some other more traditional social medias have been. But that also means that random stuff ends up blowing up sometimes.
Yes.
So you have to be careful. So as we talked about a little bit earlier, more and more it seems video is definitely king online on social media. on basically every platform now. I mean, like TikTok, and then Instagram took on Instagram Reels, which is very similar to TikTok.
I would say it's the same thing.
Yeah. For businesses, obviously video traditionally is a very, like, it takes a lot of skill to do video content. So, and a lot of effort. So if you're going to get into it, like, how do people do that?
I don't really think it's as daunting as it seems sometimes, because when you think about it, all you really need is yourself, your phone, and some editing software. And then you can create video. You know, you just have to be creative with it, and again, be intentional with the videos you make. Try to paint your brand in the best light as possible. I've really found that video content performs best across pretty much all platforms. And when you think about it too, video as a medium has probably the most affordances of any medium. It has visual components, it has audio components. So it doesn't really matter where you are, you could pretty much interact with video. Wouldn't recommend when you're driving, but aside from that, you know, video is probably one of the most widely accessible mediums.
Yeah, that's a good point. So I still think people are going to think it sounds daunting. And, like, it's nice that we, a lot of us, not everyone, has a smartphone that has, like, good camera quality for the most part. And so camera, don't need her. Editing software, that sounds tricky. And also, like, learning how to edit is a whole other thing. So what can someone do to make it relatively simple to get started?
Yeah, so you could do this all on your phone pretty much. So there's apps on your phone where after you record your video on your phone, you can just plug your footage in there and kind of cut it up. If you don't want to do too much, you don't even have to be fancy with it. Just kind of make some clean cuts to make things concise and trim some of the parts that you don't want on the video. And you should be able to make a pretty good product that way. It's relatively easy to learn, and there's tons of free products out there, tons of YouTube tutorials to help you. Mm-hmm. I'm a self-taught videographer. I had a couple classes in college, but for the most part, I learned off of YouTube. Mm-hmm. I learned through experience, and I think that's how a lot of people do it. And even if you're just looking at making a few 30-second videos, you can easily teach yourself that way.
Yeah. I've also noticed for probably at the other platforms, but TikTok in particular, there's a lot of people whose content on TikTok is based around teaching people how to post their own content successfully or become an influencer or whatever it is you're trying to do. So that can really be a great tool as well. And like you said, like, I use YouTube for everything. There's so many times out of the week that I'm like figuring out how to do something via YouTube video. So there's definitely tons of free stuff online to learn how to do basically anything.
Yeah, that just reminds me again too, if you want to use YouTube, you could absolutely leverage that. And if there's any sort of like how-tos, a how-to series that can relate to your business's mission, to initiative you have, then that is something you could take advantage of as well.
For sure. And YouTube has shorts now as well, right? So they're yes, dipping into short form content too.
Well, I just think in general, short form content is probably the way to go, whether that's the algorithms that are boosting short video content, but also people's attention spans on social media aren't very big.
And they're only shrinking.
They're only shrinking, yeah. You look at TikTok, the best TikToks are 5 or 7 seconds long.
Right.
And the same kind of goes now for every other platform, with the exception of YouTube. So you really have to pack in as much information as you can in a short amount of time if you're going to try to utilize video.
Yeah, which can work in people's favor because, like, ideally it wouldn't take that much time, literally, because it has to be so short. So keeping it simple and having short stuff could make it easy to post as long as you're focusing on the right things.
Right, yeah. It's definitely, again, not as daunting as it sounds. And I think if you as a brand can leverage video, then that can do a whole lot for you.
Moving a little more into like the consumer side of things, being a consumer on social media, looking for businesses, products, whatever that fit into your lifestyle, how do consumers use social media to find good businesses?
I think a good place to start with is the hashtags. As I mentioned earlier, it's a great way that people can just find your content by searching for something that relates to you. So if you're a consumer and there's a specific topic or issue or something that you're really interested in, you search the hashtag for that, you can find all these brands that are aligned with things that you're passionate about.
Yeah, well, and in that way, I guess the algorithm kind of works in consumers' favor if they diss the businesses that are using like random hashtags that have nothing to do with them. So that'll help you not have to sift through like all of the random stuff.
Yeah.
Because it'll show you what you're looking for most of the time.
Exactly. And also, a lot of times, algorithms take into account your location and the location of these businesses. So if your hashtag relates to a business near you, it could easily pop up when you search that hashtag because of how the algorithm treats location.
So smart. Okay, so what about like interacting with businesses?
Yeah, again, trust goes a long ways. And as we talked about in the business side of things, if you have a question, if you have a complaint or something, social media is just another customer service opportunity. And for the consumers, that gives them a lot of opportunity as well to get things worked out, answer questions, and maybe even if you haven't interacted with the brand yet, to learn more about them. A lot of times too, you can actually see, like, let's say there's a brand that you already enjoy shopping with, you like their missions, you like what they do for their employees, something like that. You can see who they follow, who they interact with, who they align themselves with on social media, and that can give you a good idea of what sort of brands are relative and also do good things based on that. I wouldn't say that a follow or a like or a tag in a post is an endorsement. It's not, but it could give you a good idea of somebody whose mission is similar to another account that you already enjoy.
So sometimes businesses are not all that they seem to be on social media. What can consumers do when they see a business that looks all awesome and great, and then they're not?
Well, first of all, if you fall victim to a scam on social media, every social network, every reliable social network has a way where you can go and report fraudulent activity. That report button is hopefully going to be something that you can use to make sure that nobody else gets scammed that way on social media, and it helps ensure that they get taken down. Of course, too, if you spot a scam on social media, whether you fall victim to it or you've just been exposed to it, please make a report on BBB Scam Tracker. That's where we get all our information from. We share it with law enforcement. It's just a really great resource.
Yeah. Well, and if there's ever an account or something like a DM that you get, or just an account you see that looks like it's impersonating another company, that's something you should report, but also you should tell the company about it because they can often, you know, get things rolling a bit faster, especially if it's like a well-known brand, and do something about that quickly.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And social media, I think each year we see a climb in terms of how many scams we see presented on social media, especially now compared to like text or phone calls or everything.
Oh yeah, those I get like several DMs a day that are just like weird, not real stuff that I have to just delete and move on.
Right. Oh, we get them on our BBB social media account. And it's like, do you know who we are? What do you think you're doing here?
Well, they're probably bots, if we're being honest.
They're absolutely bots.
Yeah, which is a whole other thing. Yeah, do you want to talk about like bots and followers on?
Yes.
Yeah.
Probably the worst thing you could do on social media is buy followers, because one, that's just not trustworthy. If you are artificially inflating your follower account, if you're artificially inflating your engagement numbers, that is a horrible image to be presenting. It's not trustworthy. You are essentially lying through your social media at that point.
And now the algorithm can tell, right? Like in this day and age, people can, they can kind of figure it out more than they used to.
Yeah, the algorithm can tell too, and it will take it personally when it sees that. Your posts will get buried. You could possibly get shadow banned too. So shadow banning,
explain what that is.
Right, yes, I just threw that term out there. Woo, shadow banning. So shadow banning is when you can still post and interact on social networks, but because the algorithm determined that you did something wrong, your posts are hardly shown to anybody.
Mm-hmm. also, if people looking at an account, you can tell. If they have a ton of followers and like zero engagement on their posts otherwise, then that's a red flag. And if you click on their followers and they're like accounts that have zero posts and random names and all that stuff, like you can tell.
Right.
So you're not fooling anybody.
Right. And that's why it's important when you come across a brand that you do that research, because you can tell, you know, if they have all real followers, all real engagement numbers, that's a legitimate business.
Right.
But oftentimes we'll see illegitimate businesses, businesses that practice poor business practices, will buy followers to make them appear more legitimate when in fact they're just scams.
Yeah. And then do you want to just talk about like shopping on social media real quick?
Yeah. Pretty much every social network has a shop element now to it. TikTok just got one too. So it's really important that if you are purchasing on social media, you know how to identify scams in legitimate products.
And do social media platforms have any kind of like protection behind shopping on them?
I think most should. I think TikTok especially has pretty tight guidelines, where if you were given something that was not what you were promised, then I think TikTok actually might offer you a refund. Other networks, I'm not so sure on that. But again, you should still be careful regardless.
Right. Like buy things with a credit card. We have to say that like every day.
Yes.
Always buy things with a credit card or something like PayPal, where you have some sort of assurance that you can dispute a charge and hopefully get your money back if something goes haywire, because you just never know. And just use caution and like look into things. Don't make rash purchases on social media, especially just because those are so new. And as much as social media is becoming more and more sort of self-regulated, it's still a place where you need to definitely be careful and like have your own back as a consumer.
And going off of that, sometimes on social media, it's hard not to throw your money places, because these platforms do such a great job at making whatever product or service they're selling look good. Social media is probably one of the best marketing opportunities out there.
Yeah.
So sometimes it's difficult not to make these panic purchases.
And you do kind of get bombarded. You do kind of get bombarded with ads on social media. I think of like my Instagram feed, for example. Your ads are also catered toward what you like.
Right.
Too. Like I get ads that are legitimate things that I am like, I do want to buy that actually. So it's not like random stuff like you would sometimes get if you're just on a random website online. That's catered toward you as well. So you do have to be kind of extra careful and vigilant, because sometimes the ads even are not super clear that they're ads. Like sometimes they look like a post.
And those are some of the best ads.
Yeah. And I have to like double take on it and be like, oh, I don't follow this account. That's an ad.
Right.
So yeah, you just really have to be like on the lookout.
Yeah. If you do see a product or something on social media and you are thinking about purchasing it, it's important to see their profile, see if it's a legitimate company based on their profile. Maybe to take a step outside of social media, see what people on the internet are saying about them. Again, BBB.org is a great resource to use, where you can see reviews and see complaints if there is any history of that on these companies.
Yeah. Like I'll very rarely actually buy something on a social media app. Like if I see, even if I see an ad that I'm like, I want that, I just go to the website separately.
Yeah.
Just to make sure that it's that website.
Right.
Which maybe Instagram isn't too happy about that, but it's just safer. It's a way to make sure that you're going to the actual website, because sometimes they'll impersonate websites and they look very real. Like same how you'll get like scam text messages and stuff where they have a link to what looks like, I don't know, Amazon. And it looks like Amazon because it's basically a screenshot of Amazon, but none of the links work or something like that. Even though the link looks, the URL looks the same, it's not a secure website, doesn't have that HTTPS with the little lock icon.
Yep.
It's a scam, but it doesn't look like one unless you're really paying attention. So they really are, scammers get really good at tricking you. You do have to be careful.
I'm really glad you brought that up, because on some platforms, it's getting easier to actually impersonate well-known brands. Twitter recently changed their whole verification process, and there's already been cases where people have impersonated a brand, paid for the verification, that's totally gone over Twitter's head, they just verified the scam, And then that way they've been able to very effectively impersonate well-known brands and take people's money.
Right, because did they change the whole, like, you can pay for one kind of check and the other one is, like, not paid for? I don't know how the checks on Twitter work anymore,
actually. I think you have to pay for all of them now.
Oh, interesting.
Yep.
Weird.
Okay. So it's really opened the door for scammers to impersonate pretty much anybody, any brand.
Right. So you can't even necessarily trust the verification marks on various, whatever they are, on each social media platform anymore.
Right. So that's why you should, as much as you can, go outside of the platform, find them that way, make your purchases on their website. Before we end this, I kind of want to shout out some social media accounts of local businesses and organizations that are actually doing a really good job at promoting what they do. Activate Good does an awesome job showing some of the opportunities they've helped with. They're really great on Instagram, where they've shown pictures of all these different events and opportunities they've worked with businesses at. They're phenomenal at that. And kind of the same vein of that too is A Note in the Pocket, who we had on the podcast last year. Whenever they have businesses at their facility to sort through these donated clothes, they'll take pictures of them, tag them, use hashtags. Those are two really great ones that you can go look up their accounts and see how they're doing things. Maybe they'll inspire you. One more I can think of too is Vines Plumbing out of Myrtle Beach. They do a great job of sharing their employees, but also some of their efforts in community outreach with video. They've really utilized video recently and done a great job at it.
Yeah.
So I would say those are good accounts if you're looking for inspiration, ways that your businesses can post on social media. I think they're awesome examples.
Well, and those examples really show just like the plethora of different fields you can be in and still successfully utilize social media to gain business and gain followers and all that stuff. Like, a plumbing company is not the first thing that I would have thought of for someone that would do well on social media, but obviously they are. So, like, that's great. And so if you're listening to this and you have a business that you don't necessarily think is something that would do well on social media, you're probably wrong. It probably would do really well. So you should at least attempt social media, because it can be a great and inexpensive opportunity.
Often free.
Yeah, opportunity to get a lot of great coverage for your business and of like spreading information super easily, way cheaper than paying for traditional advertising.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think if you're not on social media, you should get on it as soon as you can. Try to dedicate time, allocate those resources, because it could really do a lot in helping your brand connect with other brands and customers.
Mm-hmm. Well, and as... not to make it about Gen Z, but we both are Gen Z, so it is kind of about us. As we get older, like, we grew up with Instagram and Facebook and not so much TikTok, but, like, it's been around for a few years now and it's probably here to stay for a while. This is what we're used to. Like, social media is how we are used to interacting with each other and with brands and all of that. So if it's not something that you're in on, like, you're going to have to jump on it eventually.
Yeah.
Because it's only going to more and more be the way that people interact with everything around them.
Yeah. If I see a company and they don't have any social media presence, I straight up won't do anything with them as a consumer personally, because I can't really tell who they are at that point.
Right. Yeah. It's definitely like part of legitimacy now these days. You can't just rely on, because older advice, and we still hear it sometimes, is look for the brick and mortar to tell if a company's legitimate. But so many businesses are entirely online now.
Yeah.
And it has nothing to do with whether or not they're... I mean, of course, sometimes it does. And it's nice when a business has a brick and mortar store, because that's an easy way to tell that they're legitimate. But so many businesses now are entirely online and all their employees are remote and they literally don't have a physical location. So social media can be a great way to prove your legitimacy and prove that you're a good business that's doing good things in your job and also in your community or for the planet or whatever it is that your focus is.
I think that perfectly sums it up. I really appreciate you guys tuning into this episode. I hope if you're a business and you're looking for ways that you can help kind of improve how you're doing social media, I hope you learned a thing or two today.
Speaking of social media, don't forget to follow us on all of our social media platforms at BBB Carolinas. It's on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, not TikTok. Maybe eventually.
Maybe.
We'll see. And listen to The Good Guide on Spotify or Apple Music or wherever else you listen to your podcasts. We release episodes twice a month on Wednesday.
Stay safe, you guys, and we will see you next time.